Hayling Island lies sandwiched between Portsmouth in the west and Chichester Harbour and the Manhood Peninsula to the east. In truth, it's not quite an island because it has a narrow bridge joining it to the mainland. Once, there was also a railway crossing. But it still enjoys all the advantages that islands are said to possess: a close-knit community, a warm welcome, friendly neighbours, and plenty of sea, sunshine, and healthy air. Small fishmongers who sell fresh fish are, alas, becoming a rarity nowadays. Seddon's in Menjham Village is one of the exceptions. It's owned by Ian Griffiths, who spent 4 years in the Royal Navy, working out of nearby Portsmouth.
What would you like today?
Some mackerel.
Mackerel?
Yes, I really only want one.
Just one? Right, that sort of size?
Now that he's in Civvy Street, Ian not only sells fish, but goes out into the channel to catch it as well, setting out from Ferry Point at the mouth of Langston Harbour.
£1 for that one, OK?
Yes, that's fine.
That way, he can guarantee to his customers that what they buy is truly fresh.
These are grey mullet that we just caught earlier on today. Got these at the top of the harbour. Also get a few bass in there as well. We also got some cattlefish. Quite often trawled through in the harbour, about April, May time. Mainly ate by Chinese, but we also use them as long line bait as well for the bass in the summer. It's a little bit rough today, so what I'm going to do is I'll take you up the harbour and we'll go and see if we catch any eels and eel fikes and show you how we work those today. Since we've had the shop in the village, there's a good atmosphere in the village with the people in there. They seem to work together. And there's a nice community spirit and a nice feeling in the village. And also down here, really, everyone works together and helps each other out. And it's just like a little family on the island. That's really why I've stayed here. I don't really fish in the Solent too much. I'm mainly off Selsey weight. It's all crabs, lobsters and whelks I've been doing up to this season. But with the shop now, I've had to go into this sort of size boat for the speed. Some supply my own counter because they all want local fish, and that's what we're trying to do, is achieve what they want sort of thing. So we're after the local fish now. It's mainly plaice and skate, a bit of cod, bass, mullet, whatever we can sell in the shop, that's what we're after. We do our own cockles, our own winkles, everything like that really. I've been fishing now since I was 10, on and off. Really, it's just sort of determination to make a business work and enjoying the sea. I mean, I've got a great respect for the sea, and it's just a question of going out every day to make the wage at the end of the week, take your good days for your bad days. I mean, everyone really thinks you can go out there and just haul nets in and catch fish. It's not like that. There's an awful lot more into it. And there was a lot of days where you catch nothing, but then there's other days when you get an awful lot and you get a good wage out of it. So at the end of the year, it just balances out. We bought the eel fikes, we bought 16 of them to have a go with, and if they work out, we're going to go into them, jelly all our own eels up. On the rough days, we'll be in the harbour on the eel fikes, and then on the calm days, we'll be at sea with a skate net, a little bit of lobster gear, and long lining for the bass and the dogfish as well. The fishing's got worse, if anything. It certainly declined. When I started as a kid, you saw the bass out in the shallows, you used to chase them as a kid, where you don't see that anymore. But it's just like a steady plod, really. It's just a nice way of life. You do what you want, when you want, and you're just out in the fresh air, and that's really why majority of us, I think, do it around here. How many is in that one, then? Five?
Four.
About five in that one. What, one little bass?
One. Two little bass.
Two little bass. Oh, I suppose it's a start, isn't it, for the first day.
Hayling Island is caravan country. Here, beside the seaside, hundreds of people live in comfortable camps and can almost feel as though they're on holiday all the year round. But behind Nonda Souten's home in Yewtree Road is a surprise, for she is a trainer of those lovable dogs, Border Collies.
Border Collies are very active and intelligent dogs.
The little dog I'm training at the moment is called Eddie, and I think the greatest thing that you need for training a border collie is patience and understanding. Without basic obedience, your dog will just run around and do its own thing. So usually with a puppy, you train it to be basically obedient, and then it will respond to doing the agility later on. You have to make it fun, not too serious for them. They're trained from a very early age, like Eddie, and they're well used to it. And border collies excel because they are very intelligent. But we have all breeds doing it. German shepherds, even little sausage dogs do the mini courses.
Good boy.
My friends Anton and Penny have got 10 border collies, and most of them are rescue dogs, and they do far more in agility than I do. They do obedience, and they've been to Crufts this year, and they've got lots and lots of rosettes.
Go on, over!
Although the rounds are only 45 seconds, you've got to think very quickly, because the dogs have moved very quickly, and you have to run, so therefore you must be fit. You have to think ahead of your dog and give your commands very quickly. If there's a mistake, it's usually the handler that's wrong, not the dog. Dogs to me mean companionship. I definitely prefer dogs to people, no doubt about it. My dog's my best friend.
By any standards, Hayling Island offers magnificent bird watching, even though the built-up sprawl of Portsmouth, Havant and Fareham is close to the north and west. In the winter, the Brent geese are here in their thousands, thronging Langston and Chichester harbours. But all the year round, there are waders, ducks and waterfowl of every description, working and feeding on the margins as the tides ebb and flow. All of this makes worthwhile and enjoyable the job of Andy Polkey, who is the Langston Harbour Warden for the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds. This must be actually super shellback habitat. I mean, it's weed around, lots of shells and snails and all that.
Yes, there's plenty of them to blow eye on. I think there's a couple over there, if we have a look.
Actually, they're quite striking colour, aren't they?
Yeah, really very, very bright. Handsome birds. Just got those bright yellow beaks and multicoloured plumage, they look almost tropical. Not many around at the moment, most of them have gone. We've got a lot over the winter.
They're with you year-round? Yeah.
Yes, we get a handful of pairs that stay and breed when they become very, very elusive, actually. You're lucky to be seeing them this time of year. They'll start hiding in old rabbit burrows, etc., soon to breed.
Well, let's go on, see what else there is around the corner.
Okay.
What is actually the best time of year here? Is there a best?
No, any time of year is the easy answer to that question. We've lost most of the Brent geese now and disappearing to their breeding quarters. The same for the other wintering wildfowl and waders, but we've got some of the summer visitors coming back and some of the passage migrants that just passed through on migration coming through as well at the moment.
Black-headed gulls, I suppose, are with you year-round.
Yes, they are. We've got huge numbers year-round, and at this time of year, some are beginning to settle down and breed, getting more aggressive and defending their territories on islands and shingle banks.
What have we got, hundreds?
Breeding, only a handful, unfortunately, but actually thousands most of the time, year-round, of non-breeding birds.
Now, those ones out there, they're black-tailed goblets, and sort of beaks almost as long as curly but straight.
That's it, look like they've been straightened out in a mangle or something. They're very handsome birds. At this time of year, they're just beginning to go into their breeding plumage, very brick red underneath.
Even walking on their reflections, isn't that gorgeous?
It is, yes. You don't often get weather that calm down on the coast, but it's nice to see. Jim, if you have a look over there in the water's edge, you'll see one of our specialities here. It's become more common over the past couple of years. It's a little egret.
Oh, that's amazing.
Basically a small white heron.
That's a European bird, isn't it? Or an African one.
It is, yes. They've been spreading north through France, their breeding range, and over the past few years, more and more have been seen on the south coast of Britain. Unique. The number of birds that you get here and the type of birds are unique. It has a very special place in my heart and most birdwatchers' heart.
At Lower Tye Farm in Copse Lane, Michael Camp has a collection of old tractors, cars and vehicles, including this steam-driven lorry, which echoes the distant days when Michael's family ran a building and coal merchant's business at the south end of Hayling Island.
I saw the steam lorry at a sale at Andover. And with a bit of fun, I started bidding for it. And to my horror, it was knocked down to me for £725. So eventually we got it home, stripped it down, and I knew nothing about steam wagons at all at that time. But it's surprising, you know, if you're really keen, how quickly you can pick it up.
Michael also keeps horses and a livery stable, as well as traps and carriages. The driving is done with skill and grace by Anne Rogers. There are those who say that controlling a tandem like this one is the most difficult kind of driving there is.
In order to get on the horses, you have to be very patient and quiet. And you can build up a relationship with them, and they do get to know you and respect you. You have to be sort of a herd leader. The roads are very busy here in the summer because of the holiday makers, and not many people realise what horses are like, and you get a lot of people honking their horns at them and cutting on them when they overtake. Yeah, not many people give them the respect that they need on the roads. It's hardest to drive a tandem because you've got four reins in one hand and you've got one in front of the other, and they've got nothing to balance each other on. So the front horse is just swinging in the front, and the front horse is not supposed to pull the cart, so it's even harder. One of the places we do like to drive our horses is out on Burner Common, where we set the dressage and the canes, and we do practice out there quite a bit.
Christopher Pettit is 75 and a keen gardener. He's show manager for the Hayling Horticultural Society, which was founded 25 years before he was born.
My grandfather was an egg gardener. I had uncles who were egg gardeners. And my father's father was an egg gardener in Wilton House in Wiltshire. I think you're gifted, actually. That's my way of thinking. I mean, see, God's good earth has given to you for that purpose, and I think if you're gifted to do it, and it must be in the blood, I suppose, really. That's what it boils down to, isn't it?
Chris retired 7 or 8 years ago, but he still goes to work part-time once or twice a week. He worked for Vospers during the war, but since then, and for nearly 40 years, he's been employed by the Hayling Yacht Company. This is prime boating and yachting country, with Langston Harbour to the west and the mass of Chichester Harbour to the east. This means that there are always plenty of customers for the skills of Chris and the rest of the team in the yard.
As far as I can see, tradesmen are born, they're not made. If you've got the gift with your hands, you can do it. But you can't expect somebody to be forced into doing the thing if they don't want to. Now I've retired, I do go up once a week to look after the planer and the machinery to keep it in good working order, which, as you can see, you've seen, is all in good working order. It does the same job of work that what modern machinery does, actually, and it's just as accurate. I'll just check that for sharpness, you see. Well, I think it is precision work, actually, and it is accuracy, and I think you've got to be, as I say in the first place, you've got to be really interested in your job, I think, which does help, obviously. You go for, it's the same as gardening, you do something and you achieve something, and you produce something in the end of your labours, haven't you? It is an old-fashioned boatyard for the simple reason is, years ago, all boats were moved on greasers and cradles. They didn't have the lift that they got now, not years ago, when I first started up there. Everything was moved by on a cradle, on greasers, and pulled around the yard by a winch and launched down the slipway. I suppose we do consider ourselves as islanders. You have to come on to the island to get it to an island anyway, but we're surrounded by water anyway. But it is an island, and they are a very nitty community. If you're interested in your work and you like doing it, I think this is all to do with your actual own health, the way you are in your own self. Keeps you fit, I think.
There are still many precious areas of heathland and coastal meadows and dunes on Hayling Island and in southern Hampshire. Birds, butterflies and wildlife of every kind abound, and countryside ranger Peter Donnell and his team with the Hayling Ranger Service have a full-time and fascinating job keeping these areas clear and safe and welcoming and litter-free. It's a constant battle between the demands of human holidaymakers and the natural world.
During the summer, a lot of the work we do involves surveying, monitoring of the habitats and populations of plants and animals, and also monitoring of the public use of the sites. We walk a set route round the reserve once a week throughout the summer. The route's divided up into various sections, and we record all butterflies in a column in front of us. The area was enclosed originally in 1919 as a hospital, and through that fluke of history, it's remained enclosed and protected from the ravages of development which have taken place all around it, and now is really an oasis of undeveloped land in this part of the island. Over the years, various moth trapping exercises have taken place, and we have recorded nearly 500 species on the site, which is remarkable considering how small the area is. This caterpillar is the larvae of one of these 500 species, but unfortunately I can't identify it at the moment, so I'll have to look that up when I get home. The scrub we've got here in this part of the site is extremely rich habitat for small summer breeding birds, such as the white-throat. It's a migrant from Africa. There's a very wide range of wildflowers on the site. We're attempting here to protect some of the orchids which are in the grassland. We've noticed them here for the last few years, but very heavy rabbit grazing pressure seems to prevent them from flowering. So we're attempting to cover them up and allow them to flower, which would be interesting. We think they're pyramidal orchids, but in the present sort of very low vegetative state, they're not easy to identify.
Yeah, we're definitely going to need to make some more of these up.
To my mind, this is probably the best part of Hayling Island, Gutner Point. It's about 190 acres of salt marsh, mud flats. It's absolutely superb. In the winter, there's possibly up to 10,000 waders and wildfowl here, mainly grey plover, curlew, lots of brent, large flocks of dunlin. It's a magical place when the tide's rising and all the birds have pushed off the mud flats out in Chichester and come onto this salt marsh. It's absolutely superb. During the summertime, it's 37 acres of sea pink, quite a sight. And about a month after that, it turns purple with the sea lavender. And then a month after that, all the salicornia turns red, so it's a changing place. And it really has got a generally wild feel to it. It's one of the few parts of Hayling that you can say still is wild. The whole of the south coast of Hayling Island must have looked something like this 150 years ago. And in many ways, this is a time capsule of what Hayling would have looked like. To my mind, it's just as important as a historic building or any other ancient monument and should be protected for its value in that sense.
Let's leave Hayling Island with the words of veteran islander Noel Pycroft, whose family on his mother's side have lived here since 1541. And whose family clamp brickmaking business goes back to 1800 in Portsmouth and 1901 on Hayling Island.
Hayling Island was an isolated place, no bridge of course, I am talking a long time ago, and it was known as Beanshire. The people here were known as Beanbellies. Although they travelled about in various ways, a lot of them, and small sailing ships going abroad, because they were illiterate, couldn't read and write, the people in the hinterland thought they were ignorant. But of course the people on Hayling weren't ignorant. They knew that God made Hayling last, and he put the best of everything into it. He allowed nice people to live here, so we have inherited a nice place to live, nice people all around us, really a little bit of paradise.
I started water skiing at the age of 16. I was very fortunate. My mother had a house in Ibiza, and as a 16-year-old I was bored and broke, so I went down and got involved with Pepe, and he used to buy me a few beers at night after helping people teach them to water ski. I learned how to say arm along and arm straight in every language you could do, and took the money for him. In Langston Harbour, we are zoned from the period 1st of April to the 31st of October. But on inland lakes or out at sea, you can ski all year round. We have dry suits, which means that you can go out with your normal clothes on underneath and water ski and not get wet at all. But most of us prefer the feeling of the spray in the face and the water running down the back of the zip. That's all part of the fun of it. Helen Zenzening is 9 years old. She's very fortunate to have a father who's very passionate with the sport, who did own his own water ski club. And this is where most children will advance. The parents are going to spend a lot of time and money and effort progressing their children. Helen is now in training for the British Bambino team, which is for the under-14s. I'm very fortunate living on Hayling Island. It's a beautiful seaside resort, but without all the commercialism of, say, Blackpool. We've got a lovely 5 miles of beach. It's really a mecca for us without the over commercialism.
On his beachside walks, former Colonial Service officer Jack Wallace often finds fascinating pieces of flotsam and jetsam, washed up by the tides. Lately, he started bringing them home with him and using them to turn what was once an overgrown patch in front of his house into an unusual marine garden. While his wife Phyllis weeds the shingle, Jack has to find a berth for his latest bit of tidal loot.
We look out from the balcony in the morning sometime, and I say to Phyllis, there's something down by the wall that wasn't there yesterday, and I'll come and have a look, and there's a marker buoy or an old crate or some floats. And half the time I don't even know who's put them there. But I do have a few regular walkers, you know, dog walkers, who've got stuff in their own gardens that they no longer want. And they say, oh, well, I'll drop it over the wall next time I'm passing by. And that, and so there it comes, and it grows just like Topsy. Well, this broke off the groin down there. When the council workmen went to repair it, they put a new one in, and this became surplus to requirements. And they very kindly put it over the fence for me. That's where it was dropped, and that's where it went in. This is my pride and joy, the Burma Star. And if you look very carefully, you might see the words, the Burma Star, in the white circle there. I've collected all the stones from the beach and made it myself last summer. But of course, this anchor only came yesterday. A nice lady came along a promenade and was admiring the garden. I was weeding, and she said, would you like an anchor, which I've thrown out this morning? And I said, yes, I'll be around this afternoon to collect it. So I did. Here it is. Everything about living on Hayling Island is nice. I can't think of anything nasty. We were forced to move here because of my wife's health, but that's the best thing that's happened to us, I think.
For over 200 years, there's been a ferry from Portsmouth to Hayling Island across the mouth of Langston Harbour. The sea and the tides here can be tough and turbulent. Although it's only a short trip, it's a skillful job to manoeuvre between the traffic and to combat the strong currents. The pilot of the ferry is Roger Grigg, whose father was a sailor and who's always been keen on boats and the sea. Just as well, really, bearing in mind how many times each day he has to make the crossing.
I've spent nearly all my life on the water. I've always had boats, sailing, motoring, fishing, done all sorts of things through my career. And not only that, I've played in a rock band, I've been a musician for many years, and also ran my own building business and ended up back on the water again doing what I've always wanted to do. And I love it, it's marvellous. we've had several funny questions. We had a one chap once, he said, did he need a passport to go to the other side? I had an American came in once in a large motor cruiser and pulled up next to me and said, hey buddy, where the hell am I? And there was another chap wanted to know, he saw the, spotted the Isle of Wight over there and said, is that France? And two dear old ladies got on and asked, does this river end up at the River Thames? On a spring tide, the ebb tide and the flood tide can run up to about 5 or 6 knots, which is pretty fast, and it tends to rush underneath this pontoon as well. So as you come in on a flood tide, it tends to take you away sideways. And if the ferry's coming across, you can notice that actually we actually come across like a crab to fight against the tide and then swing around at the last minute to tie up to the pontoon. The ferry's trickier than a lot of boats I've driven because it's even though it looks fairly large, it's quite lightweight, built of aluminium. So therefore the wind and the tides can take it quite easily. But we've got twin engines, and with the twin engines you can control it to against the tides coming in and out, and but it's good fun. It always seems to be much warmer here. We always seem to miss the worst of the weather. It's beautiful, and I love Hayling Island because it's more rural. I feel that as I come over the bridge, I always feel that I'm coming home, and I feel that I've left everything behind me. And it's a lovely feeling as well, working on here early in the morning, and you can see all the traffic on the main road jammed up there. And of course, the commuters coming backwards and forwards on the ferry are just sitting here in peace and quiet, going across, breathing in lovely fresh air, and rather than the fumes of the cars.
In July, Margaret McCoy.
Too little help to mothers, it did not provide enough to those who needed it most. Child benefit had not been increased every year in line with inflation. The married couples allowance could not fulfill its intended purpose. Income support for children was based on family status, not on family need. Family credit failed to guarantee a living wage for working families. What the benefit system gave with one hand, the tax system was taking with the other. Now, our long-term goal is to bring together the different strands of our support for children in the working families tax credit, in income support, in our children's tax credit, and so create an integrated and seamless system of child financial support paid to the mother, building upon the foundation of universal child benefit. Already with the changes we are making today, we are creating the best system of family support in the history of this country. Now, I also had to consider the alternative case that has been advocated for a transferable tax allowance for mothers who stay at home. The better deal for mothers, I have to say, who stay at home is what we are doing from October this year, the Working Families Tax Credit. A family with two children on £15,000 a year, where the mother stays at home, would have received nothing under the old system of family credit. Transferable tax allowances, as some propose, would give them £997. Under the Working Families Tax Credit, they will receive £1,460. Where both parents need to work, we will do more to help them balance the demands of making a living and having children. With 1 million new childcare places now being created, from October our new childcare tax credit set at a maximum of £70 for one child and £105 for two, Britain has a national childcare strategy for the first time in our history. From December 1999, all parents will be entitled to 3 months unpaid leave for each child. But currently, up to 15% of working mothers-to-be are not entitled to any maternity pay. This is wrong, and today's budget will ensure that all mothers in work earning £30 a week or more, 90% of all women in work, are entitled to maternity pay and to 18 weeks of maternity pay. This is family-friendly employment in action.